بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد إن شاء الله we're going to talk about today our topic is going to be about the since the week before brother Amar he mentioned some of the signs of the Day of Judgment. So I'm going to continue that line, inshallah, and I'm going to talk about those signs leading to the Day of Judgment, and then talking about the hellfire, and then lastly ending by, inshallah, we're going to go on a little tour of Jannah. Okay? Okay, so Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu anhu narrated, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, when someone dies, he is shown his destination morning and evening, and if he belongs to the people of paradise, he will be shown his place among the people of paradise, and if he is from the people of hell, he will be shown his place among the people of hell. And this mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari. So what this hadith is basically saying is that if you're a good person, you'll be there'll be a window open in your grave showing you the place, your place in Jannah. And the same goes for the bad people and their place in hellfire. narrated Abu Huraira, one day while the Prophet was sitting in the company of some people, Angel Jibreel came and asked, what is faith? Allah's Apostle replied, faith is to believe in Allah, His angels, the meeting with Him, His apostles, and to believe in resurrection. Then he further asked, what is Islam? Allah's Apostle replied, to worship Allah alone and none else, to offer prayers perfectly, to pay the compulsory charity, zakah, and to observe fast during the month of Ramadan. Then he further asked, what is Ihsan, which is perfection? Allah's Apostle replied, to worship Allah as if you see Him, and if you cannot achieve this state of devotion, then you must consider that He is looking at you. And then he further asked, when will the hour be established? And Prophet ﷺ replied, the answer has no better knowledge than the questioner. So Prophet ﷺ knows as much as Angel Jibreel knows about when the Day of Judgment will occur. But I will inform you about its signs, about its portents. One, when a slave lady gives birth to her master, when the shepherd of black camels start boasting, or people start boasting and competing with one another in construction of higher buildings, and the hour is one of five things which nobody knows except Allah. The Prophet ﷺ then recited, verily with Allah alone is the knowledge of the hour. Then that man, Jibreel alayhi salam, left, and the Prophet ﷺ asked his companions to call him back, but they could not see him. Then the Prophet said, that was Jibreel alayhi salam who came to teach people their religion. This hadith is mentioned in Bukhari. The signs that he was talking about, are those signs that we see today? What do you find? You find that the son and the daughter, when the mother has carried them in her stomach for 9 months, and when the child is born and he reaches a mature age, the Muslims have gone to such an extent that they will call their own mother dogs. You know, to such an extent that they will try to beat their own mothers. How truthful is this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "The hour will not take place until killing will be on the increase." Isn't that the case today? He sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the hour will not come until children of fornication will be big in number. Isn't that the case today? He sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "The hour will not take place until trust becomes the means of making a profit." Isn't that the case today? He sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the hour will not come until earthquakes increase in number. Isn't that the case today? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam continues on saying, the hour will not come until singing women, dancing women, musical instruments are on the rise and will become popular. Isn't that what we see today? He ﷺ said, the hour will not take place until intoxicants are on the rise. Isn't that what we see today? And he ﷺ also says, the hour will not come until we start disobeying our mothers like we've never disobeyed her before. Isn't that what we see today? But in spite of these constant reminders, in spite of these constant signs, you and I, we still live a life of disobedience. We still live a life of sin. And people are told, repent before it's too late. And they make a joke out of it. The day of judgment is close, but in spite of this, we still brush it under the table. He ﷺ said, for 40 years, there will be no iman, no faith. There will be no iman. Then all of a sudden, on a Friday, the hour will come. He ﷺ said, the hour will come all of a sudden, without you even realizing it. He describes that before a transaction takes place, the hour will come. Or before a person lifts a morsel, and before this morsel reaches his mouth, the hour will come. The hour will take place. And now Allah the Almighty will order Israfil alayhi salam to blow through the horn. This angel, Israfil alayhi salam, this angel is such that his eyes are fixed on the throne of Allah. This angel is such that one ring of the horn is bigger than the east and the west put together. This angel is such that he does not blink. Why? Fearing that he will miss the command of Allah. And when he blows through that horn, the Himalayas, the K2, the Mount Everest, they all become flat. The hadith of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu says that the earth will shake in such a manner that you will see it, it will be like a vessel in the middle of the ocean getting battered by tornadoes. That's how the earth will shake. The sound of the horn is so terrifying. Allahu Akbar, you will see a mother who's got a baby in her stomach. When she hears the horn, she will miscarry that child. Why? Because the sound of the horn is so terrifying. The sound of the horn is so terrifying that the child who is 10 years old, the child who is 15 years old, 16 years old, his face will turn wrinkly. His hair will turn white. He will look like a person who is over 100 years old. Why? Because that is the day of reckoning. Hadith of Abu Hurairah, he says that the shaitan and his army will begin to run and they will begin to hide. Quran says that on that day there is no refuge. People will look above and what will they see? They will see the sky. The sky will look like the black filth of oil. It will crack piece by piece. The earth beneath them will crack piece by piece. The oceans will be on fire. Imagine this. The ocean will explode from their places. Allahu Akbar. Picture this in your mind. The stars will lose their shine and they will come crashing down. And there will be darkness everywhere. And when there's darkness everywhere, nothing will remain. Every single thing in the universe will come to an end. And when this happens, the narrations say, the earth will be made flat. And it will be stretched like rubber. Allah the Almighty, He will order the heavens to pour rain. The heavens will pour rain for 40 days. And the water will reach 12 cubic. Then Allah the Almighty, He will say to the bodies, form, and they will form. Then Allah the Almighty will say, Jibra'il, Mika'il, Israfil, Malak al-Maut, come to life, and they will come to life. And then Allah will say, bring the souls. The souls of the believers will come, and they will be bright. Then the souls of the disbelievers will come, and they will be dark and murky. Then Allah will order Israfil to blow through the horn again. And this will cause the souls to enter the bodies, and everyone will be awake. And they will all be naked. And they will all be uncircumcised. And they will all be barefooted. But they will be looking forward. Everyone will be saying, nafsi, nafsi, myself, myself. Your own mother will not look at you, will not talk to you. She will be saying, nafsi, nafsi, myself, myself. The hadith states, picture this in your mind. The person who has done wudu with perfection, on the plane of resurrection, there will be light covering his hands. There will be light covering his face. There will be light covering his head. There will be light covering. There will be light in front of him. There will be light behind him. There will be light on his right. There will be light on his left. He will be surrounded by light. And the same goes for the huffaz. And the same goes for the muazzin, who used to call the adhan. And these are the good people. And now will come the junkie, the druggies, the crack, the weed, you name it. This stuff will be wrapped around their neck. His tongue will come down towards his waist like a thirsty dog. Between his skin and his flesh, there will be snakes and scorpions biting him. He will be made to wear the slippers of hell that will make his brain boil like boiling water in a kettle. The person who fornicated, he'll be on the plane of resurrection. Allahu Akbar, his private parts will be placed on his face. His blood and pus will flow from it. And Prophet Sallallahu said, his mother, his father, every single person on the plane of resurrection will know that this person was a fornicator. The one who backbites, his face will be on the plane of resurrection. And his face will be transformed into a monkey. The person who deals with haram, his face will be on the plane of resurrection and will be transformed into a pig. Allahu Akbar. The person who deals with interest, he will be walking on his face. The two-faced person, the person with two personalities, he will be on the plane of resurrection and he will have two physical faces. In another narration, he will have two tongues made out of fire. Then the oppressor. The oppressor will be on the plane of resurrection in such darkness that wallahi by Allah, the hadith of Prophet ﷺ says that so much darkness will be surrounding him that if he was to place his own hand in front of him, he will not be able to see it. And in another narration, he will be made blind. And that the one who gives difficulty to his neighbors will be on the plane of resurrection. He will have no arms. Different people, according to their sins, will be raised on the plane of resurrection. And when this is taking place, this will remain like this for 70 years. Now, we will think that 70 years, okay, 70 years, not that bad. But now, here's the trick. One day of resurrection is equal to 1,000 years of this life, what you and I feel. This will continue for 70 years. Imagine how long that period is. And the narration says, the sun will be above their heads. Some of them will be sweating up to their ankles. Some of them will be sweating up to their knees, up to their waist, up to their necks, up to their heads. Some of them will be drowning in their own sweat. They will be screaming, they will be shouting. But on that day, the tears will run out. The tears will run out and blood will start flowing from their eyes. Could you imagine the plane of resurrection? People will remain like this for 70 years. And then the whole mankind will go to all the prophets, Prophet Adam, Prophet Nuh, Prophet Ibrahim, Prophet Musa, Prophet Isa. And they will all say, Allah is angry today like He has never been angry before. The prophets will say, even I do not know what will happen to me. And these are the prophets. What are we? And then these Prophet Isa alayhi salam will say, go and ask for intercession from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now you will realize the status of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You will realize the true status of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The whole of mankind will rush towards Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam will go towards Allah and he will intercede and his intercession will be accepted. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will descend. The hadith of Abu Huraira, he says there will be a big explosion. Such an explosion that people will look above. People will look above them and they will, what will they see? They will see the first heaven will be exploded into pieces. And the angels will swarm and surround the people on the plain of resurrection. And these angels, just from the first heaven, will outnumber all the mankind and all the jinn kind that are present on the plane of resurrection. They will outnumber it and they will be surrounding it. And then another explosion. The second heaven, pieces. The second heaven will break and the angels from that heaven will swarm and surround those that came before them. And these angels will outnumber the mankind, the jinn kind, and the angels that came before them. Same with the third, the fourth, the fifth, the sixth, the seventh heavens. From the seventh heavens, all these angels, bigger, every level that gets broken down, the angels come out stronger and bigger. And they will surround the plane of resurrection, and the plane of resurrection will be lighted up. And then eight angels will be carrying Allah's throne. You know, right now there are only four angels carrying Allah's throne, but eight angels, why? Because Allah will be so angry that day. Eight angels will be carrying Allah's throne. And Prophet ﷺ said that one of these angels, just imagine, one of these angels, his feet will be on the lowest part of the earth and his shoulders will be at the highest heaven. One of these angels. The distance between his earlobe to his neck will be 70 years. That's how big this angel is. Then the fire of hell will come forth. It will say, I have been assigned to take three people. First, the arrogant. Second, the oppressors. And then third, the people who used to worship pictures and idols, and will pick them out from lines like the birds pick up seeds. Now the judgment will start. First, the animals will be judged. Even an ant, if an ant oppressed another ant under a small rock, in a really huge rainforest, that will be judged that day. The ant who oppressed the other ant, it will be considered a sin for him. So these animals will be judged, and then the prophets, and then the whole mankind, one by one. There will be two groups of people that day. Those who receive their records in their right hand, and those who receive their records in their left hand. The people of the right are people who lived a life of obedience, lived a life worshiping Allah, and people of the left will be the people of the fire of hell. And who are these people? These are the people who lived a life of disobedience and lived a life of sin. And Allah will judge these people and He will say, chain his hands, chain his feet. And then the chains will enter from the back private part and come through the front private part and will be wrapped around him, and he will be dragged on his face and thrown into the hellfire. On that day, there will be a bridge sharper than a blade, thin as a hair, slippery, and there will be angels on either sides with hooks made of fire. Some will pass like a flash of light. Some will be slipping, but they'll pass. And some will be slipping, and they'll slip and they'll fall into the fire of hell. I pray to Allah Almighty that Allah makes us from those people who receive our records in our right hand. And I pray to Allah He forgives all of our sins and makes our journey easy and enters us into the highest level of paradise with ease. Ameen. And now, these people, the people who are disbelievers, they will be judged first. So they will be thrown into the hellfire. And Allah says in the Quran, Surah 15, and surely hell is the promised place for them all. Hell has seven gates. For each of these gates is a special class of sinners assigned. Ibn Kathir, commenting on this ayah, says, this means that each gate has been allotted its share of the followers of Iblis, who will enter it and will not be able, whoever will enter it will not be able to avoid it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from it. Each will enter a gate according to his deeds and will be assigned a level of hell according to his deeds. We were with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we heard the sound of something falling. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, do you know what that was? We said, Allah and His Messenger knows best. And he sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that was a stone that was thrown into hell 70 years ago. Again, remember, 70 years ago. One day being equal to 1,000 years. 70 years ago, and it was falling through hell until now. That's how deep the hellfire is. Verily, the hypocrites will be in the lowest grade of the fire. The hypocrites. Stones and rebellious disbelievers are the fuel of the hellfire. The Prophet ﷺ told us, fire, as we know, is 1/17th part of the fire of hell. The fire that you and I know is 1/17th part of the fire of hell. Someone said, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is it enough as it is? This fire that we have in this world is enough as it is. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the fire of hell is as if 69 equal portions were added to the fire as we know it. That's how hot this fire is. This fire never dies down, no matter how much time passes. Al-Bukhari reports, hell complained to its Rabb, saying, O my Rabb, some parts of me have consumed other parts of me. So this fire of hell, he's allowed to exhale twice. Once in the winter and once in the summer. And this is why you find extreme heat in the summer and extreme cold in the winter. You know, when we think of the fire of hell, we think that it's just fire, hot. No, there will also be parts that are bone chilling, freezing. That's another type of torment that will be present in the fire of hell, in hell. Al-Bukhari also narrates, delay your prayers. The Prophet ﷺ said, delay your prayers until it cools down, for the intensity of heat is from the exhaled air of hell. And these people will enter the hell and they will not leave the hellfire, these disbelievers. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, death will be brought like a horned ram and will be made to stand between paradise and hell. It will be said, O people of paradise, do you know what this is? They will raise their heads and look and they will say, yes, this is death. It will be said, O people of hellfire, do you know what this is? They will raise their head and look, and they will say, yes, this is death. Then the command will be given for death to be slaughtered. Then it will be said, O people of paradise, it is eternal, there is no death. O people of hell, it is eternal, there is no death. Then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam recited and warned them of the day of grief and regret when the case has been decided. Whoever kills himself with iron, a sharp instrument, then this iron will be in his hand and he will be stabbing himself in the stomach with it forever in the fire of hell. This is a person who commits suicide. Whoever kills himself with poison, then he will be drinking that poison forever in the fire of hell. Whoever throws himself from a mountain and kills himself, he will be throwing himself down forever in the fire of hell. Al-Bukhari states that the Prophet ﷺ said, O woman, give in charity, for I have seen that you form the majority of the people of hell. Then they asked, why is that so, O Messenger of Allah? Why is that so? He said, because you curse too much and are ungrateful for good treatment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no food will there be for them but a bitter dadi. Dadi is a really obnoxious, thorny plant. It has a lot of thorns. And which will neither nourish nor satisfy hunger. And verily the tree of zakum will be the food for the sinful. This tree of zakum, it will be like molten brass. Molten metal. It will go inside and boil their insides. So no friend has he here this day, nor has he any food except corruption or filth from the washing of wounds. Now, what does that mean? This means that the food of the people of hellfire will be al-ghaslin. Al-ghaslin, it means the festering pus and the oozes that come out of the skin. That will be the food of the people of the hellfire. The pus and the oozing blood and this waste, the excretion when you burn a skin, that will be the food of the people. And it is said that it is the juice of the people of hell. This ghuslin, that will be the food of the people of hell. Anyone who drinks intoxicants will be made to drink the mud of Qabl. They asked, O Messenger of Allah, what is the mud of Qabl? He said, the sweat of the people of hell. And in another narration, the juice of the people of hell. This is for the people who drink intoxicants. I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam say, "The person who will have the least punishment among the people of hell on the day of resurrection will be a man. Under the arch of his feet will be placed in hellfire. So the lowest level of hellfire is when a person stands and he's covered up to his ankles. That's the lowest." Lowest level of hellfire. And by this, his brain will be boiling. This is the lowest level of Jahannam. The fire of hellfire will burn the skin of the kuffar. The skin of the side of sensation where the pain of burning is felt. And for this reason, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will replace the burnt skin with a new one to be burned again. And this will be repeated endlessly. And one of the kinds of torments will be pouring of al-hamim. What is al-hamim? Al-hamim is ultra-heated water. And because of this ultra-heated water, this water will melt their inwards and their outwards and everything inside. It will melt it. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, how do we avoid, is there any way we can avoid the hellfire? There are many things that you can do to avoid the hellfire. One of them being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, fasting is a shield. Fasting is a shield with which one may protect oneself from the fire. Another thing, if you pray, your prayer, the mark that comes on your forehead, that the fire of hell is not allowed to touch that part. A heart that memorized Surah Yasin, is not the fire of hell is not allowed to touch that heart. The person who does wudu with perfection, those areas that are touched with water, the fire of hell is not allowed to touch that part. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from the hellfire. I mean, and now all of these punishments are for the people who disobeyed. Now, inshallah, I pray that Allah, that we all enter paradise. I mean, so paradise. After the believers have passed over as-sirat, the bridge over hellfire, they will be kept on the second bridge. The second bridge is between hellfire and paradise. Okay, so there's the bridge, as we know, the bridge of as-sirat, which goes over the hellfire, right? And then there's the second bridge. And these people will be standing on that bridge. And this is when they will be purified by the means of their settling any wrongs that existed between any of them in this world. So, for example, if I backbited on another person, I make it to that bridge, and at that time, before I enter paradise, I will be judged with that person. That this person will say, "Oh Allah, this person Unib backbited me. I want revenge." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him two options. He will say, "You can have your revenge, and Unib will be thrown in hellfire. Or if you forgive him, I will enter both of you in Jannah, and this person will forgive him." SubhanAllah. That's from the mercy of Allah. And then when they enter paradise, they will be pure and clean, and none of them bearing any ill will towards one another, or demanding anything of one another. And Muslim also reports from Anas radiallahu anhu that Prophet ﷺ said, "I will come to the gates of paradise and ask for it to be opened. The gatekeeper will ask, 'Who are you?' I will say, 'Muhammad.' The gatekeeper will say, 'I was ordered not to open the gate for anyone else before you.' The poor will enter Jannah before the rich." Abdullah ibn Mas'ud reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "The last person to enter paradise will be a man." Now listen to this. This is the last person to enter paradise. Last person to enter paradise will be a man who just got out of the hellfire. He will be staggering. Once he has passed out of the fire, he will turn and face the hellfire and say, "Blessed be he who has saved me from you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me something that he did not give to the earlier and later generations." Then a tree will be raised up for him, and he will say, "Oh my Rabb, bring me closer to this tree so that I may enjoy its shade and drink of its water." And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, O son of Adam, perhaps if I grant you this, you will ask me for something else. He will say, "No, O Rabb, I promise that I will not ask for anything else. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will excuse him because he is seeing something that he has no patience to resist. So he will bring him closer. He will bring him closer, and this person will enjoy the shade of the tree and drink of its water. Then another tree, a better tree, a better tree will rise up. And he will say, "Oh my Rabb, bring me near to this tree so that I may enjoy its shade and drink its water. Then I will not ask you for anything more." Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, "O son of Adam, did you not promise me that you will not ask me for anything else? Perhaps if I bring you closer to this tree, you will ask me for more." So the man will promise not to ask for any more. And Allah will excuse him because he is seeing something that he has no patience to resist. And so he will bring him closer and he will enjoy the shade and he will drink from its water. Then a third tree rises up. And he says, "Oh my Rabb, please bring me to this tree so I can enjoy its shade and a drink of its water." And then Allah will say, "Didn't you promise me that you will not ask me for anything else? And if I was to bring you closer to this tree, you'll ask me for more." He will say, no, "Oh my Rabb, I will not ask you for anything else. Just bring me closer to this tree." And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, glorified be He will bring him closer to that tree. And then when he's brought close to that tree, he will hear the voices of people of paradise and will say, "Oh my Rabb, admit me to it." And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, "Oh son of Adam, what do you want? What do you want so that you will never ask me for anything else? Will it please you if I give you the world as much again? Whatever you had in this world, I will give you." He will say, Oh my Rabb, are you making fun of me? He will say, "Are you making fun of me? You are the Rabb al-Alameen. You are making fun of me?" And Ibn Masud, who's narrating the story, he smiled and then said, "Why do you not ask me, will you not ask me why I'm smiling?" So the people around him, they asked, "Why are you smiling?" He said, "Because the Prophet ﷺ smiled when he said this." They asked, "Why are you smiling, O Messenger of Allah?" He said, "Because the Rabb of the worlds will smile when he is asked, 'Are you making fun of me?'" The Rabb, Allah will smile when he hears this person saying, "Are you making fun of me, O Rabb?" Allah will say, "I am not making fun of you, but I am able to do whatever I will." And then this last person who will enter the paradise, and this is the lowest level of paradise, this person will be given everything that is in this world that we see and we do not see, and 10 times more of it. That's the lowest level of Jannah. Everything we see in this world and we do not see, because we're living in this century, we don't know what is the next best thing. Everything, every best thing of this world will be given to us, and 10 times more on top of that. And this is the lowest level of Jannah. And Ibn Al-Qayyim said, in regards to the description of the paradise and the delights that it contains, the ground and its soil, this will be of musk and saffron. If you ask about the roof of paradise, it will be the throne of the Most Merciful. Ask about its rocks, it will be pearls and jewels. Ask about its buildings, they will be made out of bricks of gold and silver. Ask about its trees, then it does not contain a single tree except that its trunk is made out of gold and silver. Ask about its fruits, they are softer than butter and sweeter than honey. Ask about its leaves, and they're softer than the softest cloth. And ask about the rivers. They will be rivers of milk whose taste does not change, and rivers of wine that is delicious to those who drink it, and rivers of honey that is pure, and rivers of water that is fresh. And ask about the food. Then it's fruit from whatever they will choose, and the meat of wherever bird they desire. And ask about its drink. Then it is the tasneem, ginger. And ask about his drinking cups. Then they are crystal clear, made out of gold and silver. Ask about his shade. Then the fast rider would ride in the shade of one of its tree for 100 years and not escape it. You know, Prophet ﷺ also said, he ﷺ says, and this is beautiful, just listen to this. It's really beautiful. He ﷺ said, when you see a beauty in this world, when you see something beautiful that is created by Allah, a creation of Allah, and you say once, and Subhanallah just comes out of your mouth, a tree will be planted in paradise for you. And this tree is the description that was just given. So for this tree, if you were to take the fastest horse, the fastest anything, and this anything would try to cover the distance of the shade of this tree, he will not be able to do so in 100 years. He will not be able to cover the distance of the shade of this tree. Just by saying that one subhanAllah after you see something beautiful in this world. SubhanAllah. And if you ask about the vastness, the lowest of his people would have within his kingdom and walls and palaces and gardens the distance that will travel 1,000 years. This is the lowest level. And ask about his tents, and the one tent is like a concealed pearl that is 60 miles long. Ask about his towers, and they have rooms above rooms in buildings that have rivers running underneath them. Ask about how far it reaches into the sky. Then look at the shining star. Look at the shining star that is visible, as well as those that are far in the heavens that the eyesight cannot possibly reach. And ask about the clothing of its inhabitants, and they will be—they are as of silk and gold. Ask about its beds, and then its blankets are of the finest silk laid out of the highest of its level. Ask about the faces of the inhabitants and their beauty. Then they are like the image of the moon, of a full moon. And ask about their age. How old will be in paradise? Yes. Then they are young, young ones of 33 years of age, the image of Adam, the father of humanity. If they ask about what they will be hearing, then it will be the singing of their wives from among the Hurul Ain. And better than that, the voices of angels and the prophets. And better than that, the speech of the Lord of the worlds. Ask about its servants. Then there are young boys of everlasting youth who resemble scattered pearls. And when they're all like that, all of a sudden, a light shines that encompasses all of paradise. This light will encompass all of paradise. So they raise their heads, and behold, the compeller, the exalted is He. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appears. O people of paradise, He will say, O people of paradise, peace be upon you. So this greeting will not be responded to with anything better than, O Allah, you are peace, and from you is peace. Blessed are you, O possessor of majesty and honor. So the Lord, blessed and exalted, will laugh to them and say, O people of paradise, Where are those who used to obey me without having ever seen me? This is the day of increase. So they will all give the same response. We are pleased, so please, so be pleased with us. So he will say, O people of paradise, if I were not pleased with you, I would not have made you inhabitants of my paradise. So ask of me. And these are people in paradise, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking, ask of me of more. They will say, O Allah, what can be more than what you have given us? And so they will all give the same response. Show us your face so that we may look at it. So the Lord, mighty and majestic, will remove His covering and will majestify them and will cover them with His light, which if Allah the Exalted had not willed, will burn them and burn through them. Now every single cell that you have in your body will be given eyes to comprehend the beauty of Allah. Every single cell in your body will be given eyes to comprehend the beauty of Allah. And there will not remain a single person in this gathering except that his Lord, the Exalted, will speak to him and say, do you remember the day that you did this and that? And he will remind him some of his bad deeds in the worldly life. So he will say, O Lord, will you not forgive me? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, of course. You have not reached this position of yours in paradise except by my forgiveness. Then I will end by a short a little description, just a little, and inshallah this will be the last thing I say, just to give you a little sense of what it will be like in paradise, in Jannah. Inshallah we all make it. I mean, all right, so you want to close your eyes, whatever you want to do, whatever you want, go ahead. So imagine this. Imagine this. It's a beautiful day. You're sitting alongside this pond. It's like a beach here, you can say. A beach here, you're sitting there by the side of this pond, and you're looking at this bird, and you're looking at this bird in the pond that is washing itself. All right? So again, close your eyes, it's beautiful. You're sitting by this pond. It's a beautiful day, it can't get any better. And this bird is sitting, is washing itself in this pond. And you look at it, and you're just enjoying every little second of it. You're just enjoying this moment so much. I mean, looking at this bird is so beautiful. The beauty of this bird, the beauty of how it washes itself is so beautiful. You're looking at it and you're smiling. You're smiling looking at this bird. And guess what? A million years have just went by and you are just still looking at this bird and you're enjoying it. You enjoyed every single second of that 1 million years that passed by. Because life is eternal there, right? So 1 million years pass by and you're still looking at this bird and you're just enjoying its beauty. And you're smiling. And then this bird completes, it's washing itself and it starts to fly. This beautiful bird, beautiful white bird, starts to fly. And he's flying and you're looking at it and you're just appreciating its beauty. Another million years pass by. You're just appreciating its beauty. And then you feel, I'm a little hungry. You know, you feel a little hunger at that moment. Right? You feel hungry. And you're looking at this bird. You're looking at this bird and still enjoying it, but you're feeling a little bit hungry. Guess what happens next? This bird will be will transform into the best barbecue lunch you've ever seen. And it will come down into in a plate of gold and will be presented to you. This bird that you enjoyed for a million years will be barbecued, the best barbecue you'll ever have. It will be presented to you. You will eat from it. You will eat from it. Now you're thinking, wait, whenever there's eating, there's also excretion. Now this excretion, there's no excretion as we know it in paradise. The excretion will be, you will burp, and the burp will be the smell of musk. That's the excretion in paradise. So this bird, you enjoy this bird, this tastiest meat you've ever eaten. You enjoy it. Right? And you're so happy because you just had this wonderful meal and you enjoy this wonderful image. Right? And then you're done eating this bird. You're done eating this lunch. Guess what happens next? The bones that were left, they will transform into a bird and the bird will fly away. The bird will come back and it will fly away. And you're happy, you're looking at it. And that's the image. A million years passed by, you just enjoyed it. You just enjoyed every single second of it. There's no ill feeling in paradise. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gives us paradise. And He enters us into the highest level of paradise. Ameen. And He protects us from all the punishment of the grave and all the punishment of hellfire. Ameen. And He also makes our transition from this life to the next and our transition from that life to paradise as easy as possible. And we pass the bridge of Sirat with a flash of light. Ameen. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.
Do you have it on a Word document, everything?
Assalamualaikum. We're going to start with one. I know you're all hungry. I'm going to do it right then. Okay. Yeah.